was a very long narrative, and it was written in the first instance to justify his actions, because he was aware that he was going to take his own life. And as I said previously there, sir, that he wrote the statement of facts out, but he also done a supplement, an addition, and he also done a document called The Last. You have to take into consideration George's mental state at this time. He was depressed, and he obviously wasn't in a very good place. And we're led to believe that the actual original copy of the statement of facts are written, basically reflecting his state of mind. Sometimes his handwriting is poor, and sometimes the...
Just he wrote the original statement of facts to William Gibson's father. William Gibson, hoping that he was a friend, hoping that he would, you know, be able to correct the situation somehow. But the daughter, he gave it to the daughter, who destroyed it, that he'd made a copy. Being a lawyer, this was normal for him to take all these kinds of documents and records.
Yes. That's the biggest question I'd like to actually get my hands on the statement of facts. Just to have a look at it. Thanks for the question. Is there any other questions, ladies and gentlemen?
There's a rumour that he hanged himself from a gate at what is now Will's house, his own family.
I beg your pardon, sir?
The rumour that he hanged himself from a gate
at
what is now Will's
house.
Yes.
Hanging.
Hanged himself.
Hanging.
That's what we were told.
I see.
He hanged himself and shot himself.
But the market wants to do all that at one time there.
Well, the majority of the accounts obviously say the same thing, but the primary one is coming from William Balfour, who was a well-known character, apparently. He was a fisher, a part-time fisher, but he was also a blacksmith. He led the surgeon at the time. The area, I don't recall at the moment, but he was well-known at the time. So he had written a first-hand account. There was other witnesses there who actually saw exactly what happened and how the position and the body and all the rest of it, fine detail. You know, so there's no contrary documented evidence to suggest anything other than what's been basically presented. So there's nothing at all.
The house they rented at Stonemore Farmhouse. Would that have been an older house rather than the present one where Bill lives?
Yeah, there might have been a house with a garden.
Sorry, what house is it?
Okay.
because I've been led to understand it was an area house because of all the garden.
The case there, that's the start off by saying that the strength of the soil and foundation in there is very correlated to disabilities. I mean, we do tend to feel it was being some kind of suppression, some kind of deliberate, clouding of the whole affair. So yeah, there's a lot of things that we're not quite happy with. Documented things, for example, the fact that William Gibson's mother, mother's brother, supposedly a governor of Trinidad and the West Indies, and we can't find any mention of a William Mitchell on the list. So we've been through all that, so that's a question asked again.
Create some more
permanent record of the residence of George Beattie in Montrose, and the important thing now is to find out where he lived or where his offices were, or where we could put something. We try and relate buildings to people. But that shouldn't be too difficult. I think that could be done through the thorough records. You pointed to perhaps his offices being where the ties of the bank is.
Yes, I suppose that that's
that the building in your illustration, that building was not there then. So it would have been the previous building.
All right, okay. So what we came on going by Andrew Smith. Good. So he says I'm going to tell you.
The address. But that building was substantially remodeled. I can't imagine that's dated about 1860.
Okay, cool. As I say, it's all guesswork. I mean, the house, the townhouse, don't like the candidate. Well, not mentioned it, right? The townhouse, don't like the candidate you can think of. I don't even know where I heard it. There was a description of the house being between where Argos is now, and there was a poison clause, it's gone now, but in between that area, and the only house, there's one house that fits, it's got a wall around it, there's two. Yeah, and so that's the major possibility in our minds of that was the house. There's no way we actually went and chapped the door to see if they knew anything, but put details through, but it's not been here back. That's if there's any history known in the house.
Anyway, that will perhaps come out in future.
That's it.
We would be interested in working with you in that respect.
Oh, I'd love to just to see something, you know. Because there's so many people mentioned in the town, and for as I say, that to me sums it all up as the Montrose Review, because that's just the tail end of the tribute they paid to George Beattie, you know, that last paragraph. But, I mean, that's quite extensive, you know, the original, and I mean, it's almost, I've never seen so much praise by relatively unbiased, you know, people about, well, you know, technically unbiased as public journalists, you know, to praise someone to that extent, it was quite phenomenal, you know. So, I mean, obviously at the time, he was as popular as someone could ever be, you know, so not to be remembered in the town where so many people already are, is just seemed unusual. I mean, being my employer about George Beattie in particular, I just have feel an affinity with the story. Always have to, it's hard to explain, but I just have to. So.
And what was it, for any indication of what William Gibson's reaction was after the suicide? Or she wanted it out?
Well, she did, apparently she did for a while, but once she found it, this is an old way to guess quite extensive when it comes to George had written out a will. And then, yeah, it was kind of emotional blackmail. He'd written out a will, hoping that might, you know, I'm thinking kill myself, basically. And I've made a will, and I need 60 days. Please don't marry anybody else for 60 days, at least. Can you do me that favour? But apparently, he was being blocked, and there was a lot of unpleasantness. And no, basically, was the answer. So that is really the last straw for him. But ultimately, he died. The wedding had been postponed several times. Anyway, you know, because William Smart needed George Beattie out of the road. There's no doubt about that. He was a flying ointment, you know, because it was a case of that money was what he was after. I mean, that's pretty obvious. It seemed to be common knowledge at the time, according to everything all the sources were coming to us. And so he got what he wanted, he got the money, but apparently there was no love in that relationship, and she was treated pretty coldly. Cold comfort, you know, she had not done a privilege, but loveless as far as the information suggests. And she died 17 years after George in Castlestead. But during that time,
time, she had to get so much. She had to have a light on, you know, when her husband was gone, and her maid sleeping in the room because she believed she saw George Beatty. Every time lights were out, basically, but she came to realise that he was, you know, the only one that ever cared about her, and that became increasing as she, you know, her illness came worse. And it was him she was calling out for, apparently, when she died, John Beatty. So, you know, it kind of all came round. But, you know, the book extremely vilifies William Gibson. And, you know, George Beatty wanted her to be forgiven ultimately. And so this is really, as much as well we would like to, you know, because there's nothing really to vindicate her. Yeah, she did what she did, but I think she was manipulated by her mother in particular. And as I say, William Smart knew what he was doing, you know, because he ultimately, once he went abroad and, you know, to deal with his grief, he went abroad, but he had a public show that everybody apart from you was false. That was just what's documented is just a show, basically, when just coming into church late in morning gear and going to the grave and things like that, and showing them all demonstrations that he never showed when she was alive. But so this is what's been documented, and once he came back from abroad after dealing with his grief, he became very attentive to William Gibson's mother, that was Isabel. And ultimately she left him all his money as well. So we don't know what happened to Robert Gibson at all. We don't know where he's buried, we don't know why Isabel Gibson's not buried with her husband and why she's buried in, you know, the Smart family plot.
There are a lot of Smart gravestones in the old churchyard.
Right.
In the kirk.
Oh, alright, okay. Well, what we know is Robert Gibson, I think she was the first burial in that new in Rosehill. I think she was the first second, but she was definitely the star.
Because the Smarts were of Dutch origin.
Mm-hmm. All right, okay.
The name was spelled S-C-H-M-W-A-R-T. And they were Smart importers.
Yeah.
And they came here, they came to Leith first of all, and then they built a Smart mill at Logie. And they lived at somewhere called Grave End Mary Kirk.
All right.
As you can see, the gravestones in the old churchyard, Mary Kirk.
Oh,
and then they switched from Smart to Grain.
Oh, all right. They
established a grain company which is still in existence.
Yeah. But apparently, William Smart and his brother had oil merchants.
Yes.
But they must have been pretty well placed because obviously Isabel Gibson was very taken, and she obviously steered that whole scenario to that marriage because obviously she was socially hungry and wanted to raise her particular status. So, I'm sure they all got what they deserved in the end. But we just want to help if we can set the record straight and vindicate William Gibson.
Well, you certainly stirred us up. Thank you very much for doing so.
Thank you.
Good point, they are
the other ways.
Can you feel it?